Thank you to NordVPN for supporting PBS. What do the strong nuclear force, the fundamental symmetries of nature, and a laundry detergent have in common? Well, they're all important parts in the tale of the axion, a tale which may eventually take us beyond the Stanton model and solve one of the most vexing mysteries in astrophysics. The history of the axion is a classic physics tale. Intrepid scientists delve deep into trackless mathematics in search of answers to a mystery. And there, against all expectations, they find the hint of a completely new and unexpected denizen of the natural world. In this case, the mystery was a subtle inconsistency in the behavior of the fundamental forces. And the unexpected discovery, a brand new particle, the axion, which, while not yet proven to exist, may explain a much more famous conundrum. The axion may explain dark matter. To understand the origins of the axion, we need to go back and look at one of the most powerful concepts in physics, symmetry. We expect the laws of physics to be symmetric with respect to certain properties of the universe. If the equations describing a given physical process do not change when you transform a particular property of the universe, we say that process is symmetric to that transformation. For example, most of physics is symmetric to mirror reflections. The world mostly works the same when you flip the sign of the X, Y, and Z axes. Another example is flipping the charges of particles, positive to negative and vice versa. Most of the equations of physics hold up under that flip, but not all. In a previous episode, we talked about how the weak nuclear force is not symmetric under combined charge and mirror inversion. Or in physics speak, the weak force is not CP symmetric. Its behavior changes if you flip charges and do a mirror or parity reflection. Okay, so what has all this got to do with axions? Well, hold on, we'll get there. Given CP violation in the weak force, it's natural to ask if it happens in the strong nuclear force also. The strong force is the fundamental force that binds quarks together into protons and neutrons and is mediated by the gluon particle. Our best theoretical description of the strong force is quantum chromodynamics, QCD. That's a deep and rich subject that will get its own episode before long. For now, it's enough to know that the equations of motion of the strong force, derived with QCD, actually allow violation of CP symmetry. In fact, they almost demand it, and yet no such violation has ever been observed. Here's one example. If the strong force is CP violating, it's predicted that the neutron should exhibit an electric field, like you'd get from a pair of positive and negative charges, an electric dipole field. Our very sensitive measurements have found that no such field exists, or if it is there, then it's a trillion times weaker than predicted by a CP violating QCD. This discrepancy between theory and experiment is known as the strong CP problem and is currently unsolved. One of the proposed solutions to the strong CP problem is going to give us the axion. But before we can see how that happens, we need to understand why quantum chromodynamics predicts a CP violation in the first place. Compared to quantum electrodynamics, which describes electromagnetism, QCD is complicated, to say the least. For one thing, the vacuum in QCD is full of weird structure. You might ask, how can a vacuum, aka nothing, have structure? Well, in quantum field theories, the vacuum isn't really nothing. Vacuum is the word we use to describe the lowest energy state of a field, which is what you'll find when there are no particles around. And as we saw in previous episodes, the vacuum is a very lively place, particularly in QCD, where there isn't just one lowest energy state, there are infinite lowest energy states, and the vacuum can hop between these different states. But because they're all the same energy, quantum weirdness allows the QCD vacuum to sort of simultaneously occupy all of those states at once. This bizarre structure for the vacuum alters the equations of motion that come from QCD. New terms get added, and the strength of those terms is governed by a new fundamental constant, theta. It's tricky to describe what theta actually signifies. In fact, there are different physical interpretations, but one way to describe it is that it's a phase offset picked up by the quantum field as it moves between the different possible minimum energy states of the vacuum. And it's these new terms, the ones added by the weird vacuum, that appear to violate CP symmetry. That means the strong force should show CP violation, so why doesn't it? One possible explanation is that this theta value, the constant in front of the CP violating terms, is just equal to zero. That would cause those terms to vanish. But there's no good reason why theta should be zero, at least not within the standard model of particle physics. This fundamental constant may have ended up very close to zero just by chance, but physicists hate using random chance to explain the precise refinement of a value, what they call fine-tuning. In 1977, Roberto Pichai and Helen Quinn proposed another solution. What if theta isn't a constant, but can change in value both over space and over time? In other words, make theta a new type of field, a dynamic field, rather than a fundamental constant. Theta will then naturally fall to zero because that reduces the overall energy of the vacuum, and the universe always seeks the lowest energy configuration. By the way, there is actually another solution to the strong CP problem. It's that if any of the quarks are massless, CP symmetry is automatically conserved. However, as far as we can tell, none of the quarks are massless, and so this solution is not generally accepted. Turning theta into a quantum field is the most promising solution. So, you might recall that in quantum field theory, a particle is just an oscillation in a quantum field. So, with a new field, this theta field, we have the potential for new particles. Theta can oscillate very slightly around its value of zero, and that oscillation gives us the axion. It was actually two of the titans of physics, Frank Wilczek and Steven Weinberg, who first realized that this new field could be quantized to give rise to a new particle. Wilczek once explained how they chose a name for their new particle. They named it after axion detergent, because it seemed to clean up the CP problem quite well. This hypothetical axion particle would have no electric charge, no quantum spin, be extremely light, a tiny fraction of the mass of the already tiny electron. It would interact very weakly via the strong and weak nuclear forces and via gravity. So how can we expect to detect such an elusive particle? Well, even though axions have no electric charge, they can still interact with the electromagnetic field and produce photons via the strong force. They would do this by generating a pair of virtual quarks, which then decay into photons, the so-called Primakov effect. This would look like an axion turning into a photon, typically in the presence of a strong magnetic field, and photons can turn into axions in a similar way. And this actually gives us an experiment. It should be possible to shine a light through a solid opaque wall. It goes like this. A light is passed through a strong magnetic field and then blocked by a metal wall. But some photons get converted to axions in the field, and so they pass directly through the wall before turning into photons again where they can be detected. At least in theory, so far several experiments have not confirmed axions this way, at least so far. One issue may be that we just can't make sufficiently strong artificial magnetic fields. So why not let nature do at least half of the heavy lifting? Well, that's precisely what the CERN Axion Solar Telescope, CAST, in Switzerland does. If axions exist, then they should be produced in reasonable quantities in the core of the Sun. There, X-rays are constantly bouncing off electrons and protons in the presence of strong electromagnetic fields, perfect conditions for producing axions, among other things. So, the Sun's core may spew out countless axions. CAST forms the detector part of the apparatus and uses strong magnetic fields of its own to try to turn these axions back into detectable photons. No luck yet, but the range of possible properties of axions is being narrowed down. There are other spacey tests for axions. Magnetars, highly magnetic pulsars, and quasars may convert some of their own gamma ray output into axions, and that dip in gamma ray output may be measurable. In a separate phenomenon, there does appear to be a slight overabundance of gamma rays from very distant astrophysical sources like blazars. A lot of those gamma rays should be absorbed traveling through the vast, not quite empty tracks of intergalactic space on their way to us. It appears that too few of those gamma rays are absorbed, and so some astrophysicists have hypothesized that some gamma rays get converted back and forth between axions and photons by the magnetic fields of entire galaxies. That makes them invisible for part of their journey, so less likely to be blocked. Experiments thus far have not given reliable positive results, but it may be that axions are just lighter or more weakly interacting than we think, and so not detectable by current experiments. But new experiments and upgrades of existing experiments will whittle away at the parameter space of possible axion properties, and eventually we'll either spot one or decide it's a lost cause. This all seems like a lot of work for a hypothetical particle predicted from speculative math, but there's a good reason for the effort. Axions may be dark matter. They have all the right properties, no direct interaction with light, and only weak interactions via the other forces. And although these particles are extremely light, axions, if they exist, are likely to have been produced in prodigious numbers in the Big Bang. That means there could be enough of them to explain the invisible source of gravity that seems to dominate the universe, what we call dark matter. If axions do turn out to be real, they may clean up two of the most vexing problems in modern physics, the strong CP problem and the nature of dark matter. Not bad for one of the tiniest and most elusive potential particles in all of space-time. We'd like to thank NordVPN for supporting PBS. Imagine VPN is a secure encrypted tunnel for online traffic to flow. Nobody can see through the tunnel and get their hands on your internet data. NordVPN allows you to use public Wi-Fi in coffee shops or hotels or anywhere else that you're on someone else's network. That way you can access personal and work accounts on the road or simply keep your browsing history to yourself. They don't log your activity while you're online. They've got thousands of servers in 60 countries and 24/7 customer support. To learn more about NordVPN, just check out the link in the description. Last week we tried to figure out whether a universe that is infinite in size should contain infinite repetitions of everything it contains, including you. Infinite comments ensued, of which I'll now answer a finite number. Revolver Ocelot pointed out a Medium article by Ethan Siegel that claimed that even if inflation proceeded for the entire age of the universe would still not be large enough to get duplicate regions. Well, I want to thank you for giving me an opportunity to pick a fight with Ethan Siegel, who is almost always right. Almost. Ethan calculates that if the universe was inflating for its entire current age, then after those 13.5 billion years, it would be around 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 50 times the size of our observable universe. And that sounds about right. He then compares that to an estimate of the number of possible configurations of particles in the universe. 10 to the power of 90 factorial. Now, I assume Ethan got that number by imagining swapping around every particle in the universe in all possible combinations. Well, many of those particles are indistinguishable from each other. Swapping two electrons or two photons doesn't change anything, so that number might be an overestimate. But at any rate, 10 to the 90 factorial is around 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 90 within a few orders of magnitude. And I actually gave a larger number, the universe's Bekenstein bound, which is around 10 to the power of 124, giving something like 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 123 configurations. At any rate, it would therefore take way longer than the age of the universe for inflation to make a volume 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 90 or 123 times our observable universe. So Ethan is right there. But inflation would get you there eventually, as long as it never ended. And that's pretty much the definition of eternal inflation. Ethan also points out that eternal inflation must have had a beginning, so it hasn't yet lasted for infinite time. Well, also true, but there's no reason to imagine that we are near that beginning, and actually 13.5 billion years would be pretty close to the beginning of an infinitely long-lasting eternal inflation. Of course, all of this is assuming that the universe is spatially finite. The simplest interpretation of the cosmological equations derived from general relativity tell us that it may be truly spatially infinite, in which case 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 90 is a piece of cake. Paul Gaither asks, how far away are these duplicate universes? Very, very far away. Roughly speaking, you'd need to travel all the way across a greater universe that is itself large enough to fit all possible configurations of observable universe-sized regions. The volume would want to be, say, 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 123, or 90, times our universe's volume. So the distance is the square root of that. Let's say 10 to the power of 10 to the power of 60-ish times the diameter of our universe until things start to repeat again. In last week's comment responses, I corrected my pronunciation for Newton's book, and then lots of people corrected my correction. Principia Mathematica, Principia Mathematica, Principia Mathematica. Many people swearing by each of these pronunciations, so from now on, it's that thing Newton wrote. Anyway, it seems like some of you are, let's say, quite detail-oriented, and so I was terrified you'd be mad that the infinite typewriter monkey we showed was actually a chimpanzee, so a great ape, totally different thing to a monkey. But no one even commented on it. Come on, guys, if you're gonna nerd, why not nerd all the way?